in the now famous words of
Matthew McConaughey. All right, all right, all right. All right. How was that opening, John? How was that opening?
Down and dirty.
Down and dirty. Did it feel right to you?
Yeah, who was that?
That was, for those of you listening out there, thank you so much for tuning in this morning, and good morning and good night. My name is Mario Nunez. I'm alongside my broadcast partner.
Hey, this is John Dingfelder. I am so glad to be here on our inaugural show.
This is the first of its kind and the first time that we get an opportunity to sit this close to each other and just discuss all the things that are happening here in the Tampa Bay area, right?
Yep. And Kenny Loggins brought us in with Down and Dirty.
Down and Dirty. Kenny Loggins from the album Night Watch. And in 1978, do you think 45...
No, that was the year you were born, wasn't it?
Absolutely. 45 years ago. Can you imagine the people that were born in 1978 are 45 now? That's incredible.
Hard to believe.
Yeah, and so in 1978, that song was written and produced and sung by Kenny Loggins. Did he know at that time that he would be creating the song that was a theme song for the show Down and Dirty? I don't know.
There you go. I saw Loggins and Messina in Gainesville in 1976. Awesome stuff. And so Down and Dirty, that's our show.
That is our show. And for those people that are wondering, what could these two fellas who, have been in Tampa for a minute, right?
Strange bedfellows.
Two tampeños, right, of origin. What could they be doing with the title of a show called Down and Dirty? Well, let's elaborate for our listeners.
Well, and what we thought about as we've been creating this show for the last couple of months was what do folks want to hear, okay? You know, there's a lot of news, there's a lot of local news, but they, you know, they really want the inside scoop. They want the down and dirty, the lowdown on what it's happening. And, you know, we know a couple of people, right?
The down and dirty, the lowdown, the dirty lowdown. Now we're talking about Boz Scaggs, right? We could have also used Boz Scaggs, and we will.
There you go.
Because one thing that we're going to do here on the show, besides inform, right, and besides bring some of the local state and federal news items to the fore is we hopefully will entertain as well. John,
yeah, we
right?
want to have fun.
There's
and
no
and
doubt
we're fun guys. And, you know, the other thing is we want to be inclusive. We want the community to talk back to us. We want to hear what you have to say. We want to hear your stories. And so we want to have a lot of interaction. Obviously, the phone number hasn't changed, 813-239-9663. We will be taking calls. Not as many today, perhaps, because we got a lot to do, and we got a special guest.
Who's
our special guest?
He'll be
today?
Joining us here in just a couple of moments. He's sitting texting, letting everybody know that he's going to be on the air with us. That is Tampa City Council Chairman Guido Maniscalco, our dear friend. So he'll be joining us in just a few minutes. He's got lots to say. But, you know, that down and dirty door swings both ways. As you were referring, we want to make sure that the community is listening and that they're being heard, right? So if we, with our antenna as high up as it can possibly be, we miss a story, we'd like to hear also from the community. Something's important to you, we need to know about it.
And speaking of that antenna, this is a regional show, okay? We're not just going to be Tampa. A lot of people think of us as Tampa guys. We're not just going to be Tampa. We're going to be the whole Bay Area, seven counties as far as we spread. So if people have stories out there, I've already been talking to some people in Zephyr Hills about a breaking story up there. So, you know, we got a big area, a lot of things going on.
And, of course, WMNF streams live on the internet, in the interwebs, right? So that if you're listening, you've got friends in Atlanta, you've got friends in Madrid,
right?
You've got somebody in Hawaii that wants to get up at 3 a.m. to listen to us, they can do that.
And they find us at WMNF.org, and they punch that button that says listen live.
There's so many ways to find us that it would be impossible. You would almost find us by accident.
Right. But you can, in addition to calling, I think they can email us live at dj@wmnf.org. We'll see if we can handle that as well.
And there's a text number as well, 813-433-0885. So, again, this is completely interactive. You can reach out to us. We've got people standing by. We've got a whole team here working for you guys. And should we mention our screen? Should we mention our phone screener?
Oh, yeah. We've got some great people with us in the studio.
There you go. So let's talk about our engineer.
Jason Marlowe is joining us on the board. Jason, say hello.
Hello, everybody. How are
there
you doing
he is.
Today?
There he is. And listen, he's
a voice
born
for radio.
A quick study he is because, you know.
We told him if he messes up, we throw him in the Hillsborough River.
The two guys that are at the mic.
I don't swim.
Not very well. The two guys that are at the mic, we're good at a lot of things. One of them is not maybe doing what Jason's doing. So how critical is he? Well, he's the third leg of the three-legged stool. Yeah. Actually, there's four.
There's a couple more. So yeah. we are proud to have both of our wives in the studio today. Sally Nunez is here taking photographs.
With her trusty camera.
And basically with a club in case we mess up. And then my amazing, talented bride, Lynn Marvin Dingfelder, is answering the phones for us today and also helping us produce this show.
Let me say before we go any further that everybody in the studio can see me, and those of you listening know my voice a little bit from what I've been doing for about the last 13 years, the Tampa Native Show. This is radio, and we're going to come at you as efficiently and effectively as we possibly can. Those that are looking at me here in the studio today, I would be remiss if I didn't say, why am I wearing a French beret? As Council Chair Maniscalco said, you know, you're a Cuban who's now a Frenchman. I don't understand that. Well, I want to explain that.
Mario.
Bonjour. I'm wearing the beret in honor of the late, great Ray Villadonga, who I know is smiling down upon us. He was a jock here for 30-plus years. He knew how badly I was trying for many, many years to get on the air here at WMNF.
All right. So he's smiling down on us.
Ray, with love, we are with you today.
Okay. Well, you know, speaking of getting to know us a little bit better, I think we're going to – that's our next segment.
Getting to know you, John. Why can't we be friends? So here's what we're talking about. We're gonna take a little bit of time and introduce ourselves to maybe those people that don't know exactly who we are and have never heard us before on the radio. And we're going to talk, John and I are going to kind of do a little pseudo interview. We're going to ask each other questions. Actually, what we did was we came up with five items, right? Five items that we don't know about each other. And what we're going to do is we're going to ask each other or talk about these five different items. JD, are you ready?
Okay.
Who goes first?
You go first.
Age before beauty? Okay.
That's you, buddy. All right. So, Mario, I understand that even as a youngster back in the 70s, that you had a major role in creating policy in Tallahassee. Tell us about that.
Well, it may not have been a major role, but it was certainly a minor role, super minor role. For 2 years running, 72 and 73, 1972 and 73, I worked during spring break here at Hillsborough County Schools as a page in the Florida State Senate. My mother at the time worked for the Honorable and, again, the late Louis Delapart Jr., and I had an opportunity to work in the Senate, and I was there, ironically enough, when the original Roe v. Wade was debated, and it was quite an experience, and it kind of set me on a path.
Well, that sounds so exciting for what, a 16-year-old?
No, I was 14 and 15.
Oh, my God.
Just before, it was 8th and 9th grade.
Yeah, that's so cool. My son did something similar in Washington, D.C., and it was a life-changing experience. All right, your turn.
So talk to us a little bit about a factoid that I did not know. Your paternal grandparents came to Plant City in 1928, the year my dad was born, from Germany. Was born there in Plant City in 1929, and Tampa, of course, was your birthplace, like it was mine.
Sometimes, don't you wish you could have a time machine and just go back 100 years and look and see what Plant City looked like at that period of time? I know we're going to talk to Chairman Maniscalco about this, and he loves those old days. But anyway,
well, he lives in the same. He washes himself in the same a bath that we, most of us do here of a certain age, which is to say that nostalgic bent, that thirst and that longing to know more about our history and preserving our history.
Yeah, my grandparents came over from Germany, from the Munich area in the 20s. My grandfather was actually a German soldier in World War I because they drafted him at the age of 15.
To carry a rifle and run through the trenches.
Yeah, and he got wounded too. But anyway, so
Plant City, bonus points for the correct answer. For what was Plant City named? Why was Plant City named Plant City?
For H.B. Plant.
Yes, at 100%. H.B. Plant. Oh, my rang my bell and it deserted me.
Hey, you want to take a call real quick? We have another esteemed person on the air. Here we go. You're on, caller, you're on the air.
Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Hey, guys, can y'all hear me? This is Louis Vieira. How are you, Mario and John?
100%, we've got you. Councilman, how are you?
I'm great, man. So good to be on the air with y'all today. And I was hearing y'all's little conversation, and you guys sound like two very happy warriors.
Can you hear us okay?
Oh, yes, sir.
We resemble that commentary. The happiness and the joy, is it coming through the airwaves?
Yes, it is.
And Councilman Vieira, I don't know, were you there this morning for the chief announcement?
No, unfortunately, I couldn't go. My son had an interview at Wendy's, so I couldn't make it at 9 a.m. I wanted to go, you know, because I think that's important, you know.
Listen, you get Father of the Year award all the time. You're a great man and a great father and a great councilman. We appreciate you calling in so much, Lewis.
Yes, sir. No, my pleasure.
And stay tuned. You'll be a part of the show coming up in just a few minutes. Stay tuned.
Yep. Yes, sir. Thank you, guys. Take all time.
Thank you, Councilman. Well, that's great. That's good. They're out there listening. We know that a lot of people are. So let me give you that number again, 813-239-9663, if you'd like to give us a call and express your joy. Okay?
All right, my turn. Let's see. David Letterman. What's your relationship with David Letterman? Were you a guest on his show?
I wish I could have been. And so now I wish I could be with Stephen Colbert because he's taken, of course, Dave's place. So what happened in circa 19, I want to say in the 90s, 96, 97, as part of my former career as a flight attendant, I had a layover in New York City. I took the opportunity because we got there early enough in the day to go down there and get tickets to go see the show. But the backstory to this fantastic story is my parents had met Skip Henderson, which was, if you remember, the gentleman that wore the headset, who was always on set. He was Dave's floor director.
Sure.
At a New York Yankees spring training game. David used to send a camera crew down here to Tampa all the time. Fast forward, I got in touch with Skip, and I told him, I said, hey, I'm going to be in New York. Is there any way that I could? And he said, come on by. So after the show was over, sat on the floor. After the show was over, I hung out. When everybody left, I walked up on stage, sat at his desk, picked up the phone. Remember, he had a phone on the desk. And I had a couple of pictures taken. It was really a surreal moment to look out at the audience, at the Ed Sullivan Theater.
That's awesome. So
I've got one here.
Well, hold one second. I was just going to say, you know, we're both Tempanos. We were both born here. Were you born here?
Absolutely. Yeah. St. Joseph's Hospital.
Yeah, we were both TGH. We were both born in Tampa. But we both have a sort of a Yankee New York connection as well.
Yes. Well, mine is because my father, of course, was raised in New York and is to this day listening now. And he's to this day a diehard Yankee
fan. And happy anniversary to your parents.
75 years. Can you believe that?
Unbelievable.
Let's ring a bell on that 70. Is that coming out okay? We got to get a sound effect for a bell. That sounds kind of weak.
Lenny and I are going
to
go for 75. We're going to go for 75.
Two things got to happen. You got to start early, and you got to live a long time, man. You got to put in the time.
Yeah. So my New York connection is my mother's, who is listening, Adele.
Good morning, Adele.
And she's 93 years old and doing great. And she grew up right outside New York City in Paterson, New Jersey. And anyway, we have a lot of New Yorkers in the family. I graduated high school up there.
As did so. I.
Direct connection to the Big Apple, and in your case, Paterson, New Jersey. Trivia question. Another great Tampeño spent time, formative years time, in Paterson, New Jersey. There are people out there listening to this show that know the answer, that are screaming the answer at the radio.
They might have to call it.
And we can't hear them. Would you like to know now, or should we save it for a little bit?
Save it for a little bit.
You see? Our council chair knows who it is.
All right, go ahead.
Council chair, should we activate his microphone? Bring his mic up, ladies and gentlemen. Council chair, for bonus points.
Paterson, New Jersey?
Yes, sir.
The guy with the best hair in Tampa?
Possibly.
Santiago?
No.
Well, it is.
Santiago Grada?
Santiago Grada.
Yeah, he's from Paterson, New Jersey.
Easy. Well, that's the third person then. But he's from Miami before he came to Tampa. So
my Rotary friend Kevin Burns is from Paterson, New Jersey.
He's three, right. he's three notches down. No, I'll tell you who it is. It's the late, great Rick Caceres.
Oh,
Rick
yes.
Caceres
yes.
was born here in Tampa at 7 years of age. Much like you, his mother moved him to Paterson, where he grew up, and he came back his sophomore year at Jefferson High School.
In UT.
All right.
UT.
No, no.
What, are you UT fan? Or
no,
UF,
sir.
UF
no,
fan.
Sir.
I'm
Excuse
sorry.
Me, sir.
All right.
From somebody who's a Florida Gator.
I messed up.
Yeah, he's a Florida Gator. Okay, is it my turn or yours?
I don't know. You
oh, it's mine. All right. So, salud and happy days. Most people know that that's kind of my signature sign-off at the Tampa Native Show, but it's also something that most of us know from Andy Hardy and Manuel Barrow, and it says right here, our family was responsible for Andy Hardy coming to Tampa at WTVT Big 13. Johnny, explain yourself.
The Dingfelder family was responsible for Andy Hardy coming to Big 13 back in the 60s, and you know what? We're out of time on this segment, and we're going to have to carry this over until next week.
All right.
People are going to be hanging on the edge of their seats.
Getting to know you, getting to know things about you, we call this segment. But listen, moving on.
To our good friend.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed. You've got a friend in me.
Hey, what do you got on that board over there, John?
Well, you know what? Let's introduce our friend who's in the studio a little bit better, and then we'll come back to the board. Go for it.
Our friend and me. So our friend and our friend who already introduced himself, kind of because he gave us an answer, Santiago Corrada. Ladies and gentlemen, now in his third term in office, is this correct? Acknowledging me with a nod of the head. Now in his third term of office, our esteemed city council chairman and a dear friend to us and to the show and to the community. Do I get any credit at all for launching your career? I don't know. Guido Maniscalco, everybody. This is where we come in with the applause, which we'll have that next week loaded in the machine.
Standing ovation.
Thank you.
Welcome, Guido.
Welcome, Guido.
Thanks for having me. So, Mario, I think you were there in the early days with the great debate.
That was it, the great debate that never happened.
The great debate that never happened. So you know me well. You've been here since the beginning in many ways and as a friend. And John, we've known each other a long time. My father affectionately calls you Dangerfielder. He never gets the last name right, so it's John Dangerfield.
He says it lovingly.
Lovingly. Well, you know, my dad, you know, he's one of those guys, you know. But yep. Thanks for having me here. This is a great opening segment. So
beautiful.
Shall we begin?
So, Guido, I want you to, we had this wonderful opening at Memorial Day on Monday for the Vila Brothers Park, and you have been instrumental in that park. Tell us a little bit about the Vila Brothers and the whole thing, 18 years struggle.
So the Vila Brothers, seven brothers that served throughout the 20th century, starting in World War II all the way to Desert Storm in different branches of the military. And in 2005, under the Ayora administration, and when you were there on council, Dingfelder, the park was dedicated right there on Armenia across from Fort Homer Hesterly Armory, now the JCC. But for many years, it sat dormant. It was an open field that had basketball courts, but it was a very simple park. And I would drive by every single day. And I would say 10, 12 years ago, I met Mr. and Mrs. Hector Vila, Martha Vila, by coincidence, and he gave me the business card. You know, what's in a name? Seven brothers, right? So that's when I discovered, really, that what is behind the name Vila Brothers. But for years, you know, the community and the neighborhood and the Vila family had asked for improvements to the park. And it wasn't until city council stepped in several years ago with the help of Sandy Sanchez over at Armory Gardens and Martha Vila about getting the improvements done to the park. And it's, you know, it's never easy. It's millions of dollars in improvements. But with city council, with the support of city council, taking it to the mayor, when, you know, we have those annual budget meetings and discussions, we want to get this done. If you saw that Julian Lane Park got millions of dollars years ago, Curtis Dixon before that, millions of dollars for improvements. But Vila Brothers sat quietly. So with the help of city council and the neighborhood association and community leaders, we really got that done. And Monday was the official rededication with all the improvements.
Okay, so on Monday, I played Joe Reporter and went out there and caught some sound bites for a clip.
For 71 years, my name has been Mrs. Hector Vila, and I have served as the advocate of the park since Hector said, "Honey, I have an idea I want to talk to you about." Well, I heard the idea, and I thought, this man is crazy. He said to me, I am so proud of my family that I would like to leave something for future generations.
This is Councilwoman Gwen Henderson. How do you feel about the park?
Absolutely amazing. You can really tell that Martha is the queen of her family and what she has done to make sure that this has happened. The patience and perseverance to make it happen and it coming to fruition today and celebrating on Memorial Day is absolutely amazing.
Luis Vieira.
Yeah, so this is really important. You know, Tampa City Council passed this a few years ago, obviously by unanimous vote, and we're 100% united in supporting the Vila Brothers Park, and it's great that we came out here today to support the Vila Brothers as well as Memorial Day.
I think, as I recall, didn't Guido add it to the budget?
Yes, he did. So, interestingly, the first thing, the bathrooms got passed in 2017, $200,000 for bathrooms, which is interesting. And then you're right, which is Councilman Maniscalco added this to the budget, which I think was about $2 million, if I recall correctly. And here we are.
So it started with the Iori administration in 05, but it was very simple. And then with this last council, we pushed for the park improvements that you see today, the updated playground, the walking path, you know, the trees that are being planted, the shelters, to make it a complete park. And not only that, it's red, white, and blue. So it's patriotic. It sticks to the theme, the importance of patriotism, the Vila Brothers family.
What's your name?
James Clear.
Well, how do you feel about the park? Did you just move in around here?
No, we've been here for almost 4 years now, so I've kind of seen the transition of the park, and it's excellent because I have two daughters, 8 and 10, and they love to come play over here.
What do we got going on here, sir?
30, 40 kids, all ages, decked out in red, white, and blue with their flags and their beads, ready to go walk by the new playground. And this is the Children's Patriotic Parade at Vila Brothers Park, celebrating the reopening of the park.
One, two, three, go Vila Park!
All right, well, that was fun, and I really enjoyed being out there in the park. If you have an event, you please email the station. I'll give you that email address either this week or next week and tell us to, you know, be able to come out to your event. We have Luis Vieira back on. I think I hung up on him before. But, Luis, we appreciate all you've done. You and Guido really teamed up on the park. Are you there?
Yes, sir. I'm here, John.
And tell me a little bit about your feelings. I know you were very proud that day. You were master of ceremonies.
Yeah, no, it's a great thing for the community to come together. You know, Tampa's a very patriotic city. And, you know, I've always felt that a lot of times the city of Tampa kind of defers to the county on things like that. And I don't think that's right. And I know, you know, that John, Mario, and Guido, I'm sure if Guido's still online, agree with that, which is that, you know, we ought to take our lead as the city of Tampa on things like that and not defer to the friends that are our friends over in the county on that.
And one of the things that Guido and I were talking about, the chairman and I were talking about, was about neighborhood empowerment, Luis.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you were there several times when Martha came in and just urged council and urged the city to do something, you know, and it took 18 years. Tell us about how your feelings on neighborhood empowerment.
Oh, yeah, that's critical. I remember the first time Martha came into Tampa City Council, it was like in 2017 for a challenge with the park. And, you know, she came in. I believe her late husband, Hector, came in with her. Of course, he passed on a few years ago. I believe it was 2.5 years ago. God rest his soul. And just her story was very, very powerful. So when people come in with powerful stories, whether it's in Bush Boulevard or East Tampa or Sulphur Springs or South Tampa or West Tampa, whatever, you know, I think that council listens. Because we want to fight for a good cause involved.
And council's accessible, too. You know, a lot of times, and I'm not picking on the administration, but all administrations, it's harder to access the decision makers. But anybody can come down to city council, take their 2 minutes, and tell us, you know, how they feel about the community and what's going on. And that's, you guys do a great job on that. Luis, we appreciate you calling back in.
Yes, sir. Well, listen, good luck on your first show, and anything I can ever do to help you and Mario, you guys let me know.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
Thanks.
Thank you, Councilman. And just a quick reminder for those people, if you're just joining us, you're listening to Down and Dirty with Mario Nunez and John Dingfelder on WMNF 88.5 FM or streaming worldwide at WMNF.org.
Okay. So, Guido, anything you wanted to add? We had a big event this morning at City Hall. Tell us about that. You were there.
This morning we had a press conference from the mayor announcing the new choice for police chief. And, you know, there, the last time around there was controversy. This time it was quiet. Lee Burkhall, who has been interim chief, is the mayor's choice to go forward after council's approval to be the police chief for the city of Tampa. I've known him since I got elected 2015, always had a good relationship. He's been on the force for, I think, since 1997, you know, so
he knows. He has a doctorate. I read that this morning, a doctorate in law enforcement. That's pretty impressive. We need to call him Dr. Burkhall.
I will do that, just like
Chief Doctor? Chief Doctor?
Chief Doctor. Chief yeah, Doctor Chief.
Doctor Chief. Chief.
Yeah, whatever works. But, you know, it went well. And, of course, that's a big announcement, and that would come before City Council, I believe, on June 15th.
So what's City Council's role in that?
We would have to vote to ratify, you know, or approve that selection.
Okay. And it's not necessarily always a slam dunk, as we saw with
Mr. Smith.
No, with the previous chief. It wasn't.
No, with Delgado.
With that
whole Delgado business, you know. Well, so it's not always a slam dunk. Council's vote should not be taken lightly, correct?
Absolutely not, you know. And the mayor, I believe, reached out to every council member. She reached out to me. And I think, you know, communication is key. You want to put it all out there, talk about it, and not go into a potentially volatile situation where you don't know what's going to happen. Yeah. You know, communication goes a long way.
On the down and dirty side, Jason had some strong feelings and thoughts on this.
I mean, it is a little shocking, right? 4 years, the mayor has been the former police chief. We've gone through four police chiefs in 4 years. I mean, at this point, we're like TLC rotating out members. It's a bit much. So I figured, you know, something to be worthy of discussion.
There you go. We're optimistic that Lee Burkhall is going to be a great chief. You know, I do know him. I think he's a good man. I think he's solid. I talked to Yvette Lewis this morning.
NAACP.
NAACP. Mm-hmm. And she's, you know, she feels comfortable with Burkhall. She's been having conversations with him over the last 6 months. She said she's going to wait and see how he performs and if his communication continues. So that's a little bit of a challenge. But that's part of the down and dirty that we're talking about here, Mario.
And one other thing that I wanted to mention to Chairman Maniscalco is, and a lot of people that I talk to and a lot of people that I engage over the topic of the Sulphur Springs Tower, just recently on the news, there was a segment about springs and refurbishing and revitalizing, reinvigorating and reanimating. And there's a lot of re's there. Did you hear all those re's? our local springs, because they are the lifeblood of our estuaries and our water supply. And the one that was featured was, of course, Sulphur Springs, which has been a dead spring for many, many years. They're hoping that they can bring it back. That said, I would just like to make an appeal to the council chairman at this point to maybe take up the topic of the tower. And I'm looking at you now.
Sulphur Springs Tower.
I want to stay in front of my microphone. The Sulphur Springs Tower, because I think that it's iconic perhaps as the minarets atop
starting
the university.
Starting to look a little dirty, a little dingy.
And a little down and dirty, right? Yeah. A little down and dirty. So we need to just kind of attend to it. If we're going to put money into the spring and revitalizing the spring, then let's do that. It could be a featured. You know what it was used for originally besides an active water tower?
What's that?
It was also used as an aviation dead reckoning point.
Oh, wow.
for the Army Air Corps when they were flying into Drew Field, at low altitudes, you know, VFR, visual flight rules, they would use the tower to know, okay, I got to bang a right now. I got to go west.
Okay.
Right? I got to go towards the field. So it's such an iconic.
And Drew Field,
which
for those of
became,
you who don't know, Drew Park, and that's right next to on the east side of Tampa International Airport.
And Drew Field actually became later, Tampa International Airport. But my point is, I just at some point I hope that the council will take that up and can we get a pinky promise from you right now? Come on, right here, put it on.
I already got it in the last budget. There's
Atta
funding
boy.
There
see,
for cleaning and restoring the tower.
Ring the bell.
Too late. We're working on it.
Thank you, council.
You also failed to mention Tower Drive-In. That property was a drive-in theater. So
absolutely.
You know, long gone, but still, no. The funding, we've already allocated it in this. existing budget specifically for the tower.
So we've got a very patient person.
Let's honor those calls, John, shall
we? Okay, Drew Smith is coming in right now.
Okay, there he is.
Hello.
Caller, tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Oh, I am calling from the USF Tampa Library.
Very nice.
And I could not let the first episode go by without wishing you well and hoping that this leads to great things.
Thank you, Drew. Tell us a little bit more about what you do. I know you personally, but tell everybody else what you do for us.
Sure. Well, for the last number of years, I've been a librarian at USF here in Tampa, and I've been able to focus on genealogical research. So I've been helping people for many years with doing family history research. I was so thrilled to hear John talk about his family from Germany. And as John knows, back in around 2015, I first met Lynn, his wonderful wife, and did research on her family. And I had a lot of fun with that. So it's something I still do. I'm going to be retiring from my full-time job as a librarian in 2 months, where I can devote all of my time to doing genealogy, which I'm thrilled about. And I did also want to say, for the listeners, since the whole county is Hillsborough, I know you go beyond Hillsborough County, I'm going to be giving a bunch of talks at public libraries starting tomorrow morning at the Jan Platt Library. That's at 11 o'clock. And I'm going to be speaking at 7 different libraries to help people get started doing DNA testing.
Drew, we're so excited for your new venture, and we know that the retirement is not really retirement per se, because things are really going to start ratcheting up for you now. And look, we are about to launch our new Facebook page, and our social media footprint will sort of improve and increase. And as we do that, please feel free to post on our page. We'll certainly approve it, so that way we can get your information out to the public.
Drew, we're so glad you called, and we appreciate the help with the Marvin family a couple of years ago.
Absolutely.
We're going to take another few calls, Drew, but
thank you,
again.
Drew.
Stay tuned.
Thanks for having me. All right, okay. Bye-bye.
All right, Mario, I think we've got somebody from Sarasota. We're out there today.
Caller, tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Hi, I'm Dave from Sarasota.
Hey, Dave.
Hi, how you guys doing? I wish you guys good luck on your new show. What I wanted to comment about is I really loved the rib sets they used to have back in St. Pete. And maybe someone can put someone here in one of the regional governments to bring that back. It was really great music, great food, and it gave a lot of money to the charities in the area.
I know last week on The Skinny, Manuel Leto was part of that, and he's on that show, and he's the chairman of Preserve the Berg, which is
does a great job.
Yes, he does a great job, and it's all about preservation of St. Petersburg and their history and so on. But he might be a wonderful source infiltrate
for sure
to get that word back to we remember Ribfest. Yeah. I mean, we remember.
Yeah, Dave. So St. Petersburg has a phenomenal history, just like Tampa. And really, between Tampa and St. Petersburg, it really sets us off differently from other cities across Florida, like, Orlando. Did I say that?
Yes.
They have a lot of great events going on.
Yeah, a lot of great events. But Lynn and I were driving through the other day, and I was telling her about Diston, D-I-S-S-T-O-N, and how he was the Henry Plant bringing the railroad to St. Petersburg, back around probably around the same time period as Henry Plant.
So that's where they got Plant City from.
Yeah, well,
absolutely.
Definitely.
Yeah, HB had a big influence on the area. Without him, and I think Mr. Ebor, well, we can discuss that on another show. We would be a whole different dynamic here, a whole different city. Thank you so much for calling. We take your words to heart, and we hope that we can see Ribfest back on the map soon, very, very soon.
Yeah,
thanks
good
for
luck
calling.
With that,
and please keep
questions.
Listening. Please keep listening. Thank you for calling from Sarasota.
All right. Mr. Chairman, tell us what else is going on at City Council. City Council is sort of rock and roll in 2022 and the beginning of 2023. Inside word to me tells me things have calmed down a little bit under your sage leadership.
I don't know if it's about me or we've turned over a new leaf with the new council. There's some new members on there.
Who's that?
New energy.
We have council member Alan Clendenin, who's the vice chair, and Ooh. We have council member Gwen Henderson, who serves as the chair of the CRA.
We had a little clip of Gwen Henderson on
yes.
On
go Dragons.
Yes, a Jefferson Dragon.
Very proud to be a Jefferson Dragon.
There are many. Councilmember Miranda, our clerk, we're surrounded by Jefferson Dragon here in this room, so you can't escape it.
I'm going to give a shout out to my good friend, Councilman Orlando Goods. Mm-hmm. He did a great job. They came close. Councilwoman Henderson beat him slightly. I told her the other day, I said, I love Orlando Goods, but welcome aboard and life goes on.
Let's go. Yeah. And let's go.
We have to work together. You know, I mean, we're here to serve the community for the betterment of the city. We can't solve all the problems, but a divided council, it just doesn't work, you know. And I see a better relationship between the mayor and the city council. I think we all want to move forward together. So fingers crossed, you know, I hope that we maintain that peace, but the constructive team, you know, and getting things done.
So listen, we're taking calls this morning, 813-239-9663. And we have a call right now. You good with that, Mario?
I'm good. Let me go ahead and do my thing. Here we go. Caller, you're on the air. Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Good morning, gentlemen. This is Joe King Carter.
Hey, Joe.
Hey,
what's up,
Bubba,
King?
What's up?
Oh, we're so happy to hear your voice. I'm going to ring a bell for you, buddy. But I tell you what, I don't even know what's happening with my bell.
It's
terrible.
Erectile dysfunction.
I don't even. Listen, I'm not bringing that bell anymore, but we got to get a sound effect for a bell.
Bell from Notre Dame.
Bell. Hey, King, tell us what's new in your world.
I had to call on your maiden voyage and say congratulations. You guys are sounding awesome out there in the radio wave world. 3 points I want to bring up real quick. I just want to say, Guido, I remember as a young corpuscle moving through Ybor City early on, and I've always had a fondness for Guido, and I appreciate his style of politics, which is positive, positive, positive. And he's done a great job, as well as John did in his service to the community when he was on council.
Thank you very much.
I want to get that out of the way, number one. Number two, berets are worn by Italianos as well as French, as equally so. We associate the beret with French folks, but it's not necessarily so. And in the early days of Ybor City in the 60s and 70s, tour guides, history guides, you can find photos of them. Today, the popular thing is a Panama hat or some kind of a fedora-style Panama hat. But in the 60s and 70s, tour guides wore berets. So
thank you for validating my beret, Joey. I appreciate
there you
that.
Go.
He
there
needed
you
the validation.
The Basque also wear berets, which is, you know, that area of the Pyrenees between Spain and France. I do digress.
Absolutely, but you are correct in your position. So, and the third thing I have is listen closely. I have a hotelier's bell right here.
Oh my goodness.
And I am going to gift it to you.
Oh, my goodness.
Because
that's awesome.
You don't need a digital bell, my friend. This is
there it was.
You must have your flesh touch that knob and make that impression in the world.
So to speak.
Joe King, we appreciate that gift. Oh, we appreciate your call. And we got a couple other folks waiting online.
Absolutely.
Stay tuned. Well, next week is Pledge Week. And please join us.
Love you, King. Thank you, brother. Thank you.
All right, good luck. Take care.
Thank you.
All right. And here is somebody with a familiar name.
Caller, you're on the air. Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Hi, my name's Tom Skerritt, and I'm calling from Tampa.
There you go, Tom. How are you today?
Great, great. Mario, I have to tell you that I love berets.
Thank you.
I have a whole collection of them. I lived in France and started loving them there, so
it's a very functional chapeau, is it not?
It is, and very stylish.
And Tom, could you get us a little exciting? Talk to us in French a little bit.
Alors, je m'appelle Thomas Carrie, j'étais étudiant de.
To
Paris.
Oh, you know the women are going to be flocking to you, Tom Skerritt.
So Gomez Adams, you know, was driven crazy every time Morticia dropped in a little French. You know what I'm thinking?
Tom, say good morning to our good friend Chairman Maniscalco.
Hey, Chairman Maniscalco, how are you?
Great, how are you?
Good. Bonjour, great. Bonjour.
Yeah.
All right, so Mario, I have to tell you, John and I were law partners for 8 years. We've been friends for 35.
That's excellent.
So I have amassed a war chest full of slightly embarrassing stories, which would not be appropriate for the radio. But you know, at some point.
All right, Jason, quick, cut him off. Cut him off.
No, we'll definitely have you on. Tell him. Listen, I think it would make for a great, entertaining show. And if you're willing to come in and sit with us and share the stories that you can, we'd love to have you on.
The more embarrassing, the better.
Thank you.
and you're free to wear any one of your colorful berets. Thank you.
So actually, here's a true story real quick. But my 50th birthday party, we had a big birthday party because I combined it as a campaign event. And Tom wrote out this beautiful speech, that he wanted to give. And I didn't trust him to do it because I was afraid of what he was going to say. And so
that pretty much explains our relationship.
Sums up the relationship. Yeah.
Then I read it later on the next day and I felt really bad because it was all nice things.
It was sweet things.
Tom, tell Linda we said hello and give our love.
Great call. Thank you so much, Tom. We really appreciate you taking the time this morning.
Absolutely. Great job, guys. It's going to be a lot of fun.
I think so, too.
And listen, you got your finger on the pulse of all sorts of things out in the community, so make sure that you've got our phone numbers and call us. And
keep us posted.
Phone us and text us and everything else.
We'll do it.
Thanks, Tom.
Bye-bye.
All right, guys. Bye-bye.
That was a great call. Huh? Here we go. We're getting callers. They're lining up. If we still have time, we got about 13 minutes left in show. So let me give you the number again. It's 813-239-9663. If you'd like to send us an email, you can do that at dj@wmnf.org. And you can always text us at 813-433-0885. And I should have asked this question earlier to our engineers. Where do the emails show up? Because we may be getting some emails.
Probably over here on this screen that I'm so technologically inept.
Well, there's a little dysfunction here at the table this morning in the way of technology. I don't mind. Listen, we don't run out of words. We got plenty of words and stories. And we know how to lean into the mic.
Well, this show is running on cuneiform tablet. We chiseled this into stone this morning. And, I would appreciate, let's not besmirch Nebuchadnezzar and Gilgamesh here.
Thank
on
you, sir.
Air.
Thank
you,
sir.
They deserve some respect.
Thank you, sir.
But we have gotten lots of well wishes. Gary Gibbons reaches out and wishing us a great show all the way from St. Pete. Lots of folks reaching in, just having wonderful things to say, congratulating us on the new show. We're all just so happy to be here.
Wonderful, Jason. Thank you for covering me on that because I was wondering where they have to be out there sending. Because at times I'll send an email myself when I'm listening. And look, this will be a great opportunity for me to say on behalf of my broadcast partners, what an honor it is to be joining the WMNF family of broadcasters, right? Because whether we're doing music or we're doing public affairs and news, it is just an honor and a privilege to be in studio here. I know this has been a quest of mine for so many years, and I'm grateful, and I want to express that over the airwaves. Thank you, everybody who made this possible.
All right, Mario, speaking of neighborhood empowerment a few minutes ago, we've got a fantastic neighborhood leader coming in right now.
Caller, you're on the air. Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Hi, Janice Davis, former president, past president, Davis Island Civic Association. And I want to welcome you all on your launch. I'm excited for both of you. And I just want to talk a little bit about how important it is for community engagement. We're all concerned about things that are happening in our neighborhoods. And John has been such a great leader and steward. And I want to say that let's continue. Let's get more involvement in our community so that those engaged can make a difference and continue to make a difference on our great Tampa Bay.
That's it. And that, Janice, thanks for calling. That's what it's all about. Everybody's got a different role, but we all work together to make this a better community. And it's not just about our elected leaders. They can't do it by themselves. And Janice, you and Davis Island folks have been the leaders of the leaders in terms of neighborhood empowerment and letting council know and letting the mayor know over the years, what is needed, not just on Davis Island. I mean, you guys have led through through Than as well. And we'll talk to Stephanie Pointer about Than on another show. But Janice, thanks so much for your kind words and for calling in.
Thank you, Janice, so much.
Thank you. Keep it going. Bye-bye.
Thank you. And to the chairman's point, it does take everybody. A democracy, we've said this before, is a participatory sport, if you will. And, that's why they have people in their employ. I'm talking about the city councilman to take your phone calls. They're there to make sure that your voice is heard. And if you have something more pressing, then go and present yourself for public comment.
Mario, to your point, it's almost like we need more than 13% turnout for municipal elections.
Oh, 100%. And that's
almost like...
Well, that's going to be our personal goal next election.
There
is,
you go.
Is
there
to
you
get
go.
That turnout.
You just gave me, what do they call that?
Goosebumps.
Chicken skin? Because that hit more than a nerve with me.
All right, we've got another good friend coming in.
Caller, tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Hey, this is John Rodriguez from West Tampa.
Hello, John Rodriguez from West Tampa. There's a familiar voice and destination.
Hey, John.
Hey, it's good to see that you guys are on the radio, and wanted to confirm that, I just turned 60 in February, and when I was a kid in the 60s and 70s, my dad used to wear one of those black berets pretty commonly.
This has become
and,
a beret episode.
You still see them. You still see them occasionally in a West Tampa sandwich shop, people wearing them.
There you go.
Thank you for validating my choice of chapeau today, John. I do think it's appropriate. I did it because of my affection and fondness and respect and love for Ray Villadonga. But to your point, let's bring them back, John. What do you say? You, me, Tom? I'm going to get the guys in the studio to start wearing them,
Welcome
too.
Welcome to the Beret Support Hour
No doubt about it. And I'm going to tell you something.
Are you insecure about your hat choices?
John Ziegfelder could use a beret, a good beret.
All I can say, Mario, is you look marvelous.
Absolutely marvelous.
Hey, listen, John Rodriguez, before you go, I want to give a shout out because these are the guys behind the scenes who make the sausage.
Absolutely.
You know, John Rodriguez has been there
and they do the down and dirty work.
In support of Bob Enriquez. City of St. Pete, City of Tampa, all across the area. Guys like John Rodriguez have been there in Tallahassee and in Tampa making good things happen.
Unsung hero.
And Guido, you got something on that?
Oh, sure. You mentioned so many great people. John Rodriguez, I've known him for about 13 years. Great, great human being. Great West Tampeño.
Atta baby.
And then
there
you mentioned
go.
Ray Villadonga, who I got to know a little bit.
Great Asturiano.
He was the Frank Zappa of Tampa.
Absolutely.
If you look at pictures when he was young, you don't know if you're looking at Frank Zappa or Ray
Villadonga.
Yeah, great, great guy. Very much missed.
John, thanks for calling again, and we'll talk to you next week.
Thank you, John. Caller. You're on the air. Tell us your name and where you're calling from. We're so happy you're there. Caller, are you with me?
Hello? Are you talking to me?
Oh, yeah.
I'm talking to you.
Hey, I'm talking to you. Are you talking to me? I'm talking to you.
Well, I keep hearing, hello, caller, hello, caller. This is Anita Henriquez, AJ.
Hi.
People on Facebook. I just wanted to call and congratulate you all on the new show.
Thank you so much.
A couple of sticking points. I am a West Tampa native. Beach Street, 2100 block.
There you go.
Let's go, Beach.
My home is still there. And my grandfather's restaurant is right on the corner of Howard and Beach.
Beautiful.
And I live in the northern part of Hillsborough County now, up in Odessa.
Uh-oh.
I represent...
But Anita, you took your West Tampa accent
all
the way up there to Odessa, so that's good.
And that's a long way to drive to get a good cup of cafe con leche. I'm just saying.
Well, the Henriquez's have a little compound up here, so it's
okay. I bet they do.
Anita, we look.
Just two points.
Uh-huh.
The beret, the Spanish version is boina, and my grandfather used to wear one every night to sleep
and
when it was cold.
Correct.
And my uncle Willie Garcia used to wear a boina quite often.
Willie Garcia.
And
great man.
Yes. My father was the oldest brother. He was the baby. My Aunt Matilda Garcia Martinez.
Oh, my God.
She was married to the second brother. And they had a tradition when they had family trips. They would all wear red berets, whoever was in the trip, so they could find each other.
Like the Guardian Angels in New York, when they made the red beret. We're giving a little history here because that's what we do. Down and dirty.
We are running out of time for today. We're going to take one more quick call.
Okay.
Up against the clock.
Thanks, Anita, so much, honey.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
All right, one more quick call, and then we are going to wrap up.
Caller, you're on the air. Tell us your name and where you're calling from.
Chip Wiener, Tampa, Florida.
Chip Wiener.
Hey, there he is. There he is. There we go. Wait. This bell is going to go in the file 86.
Sally's shaking her head.
The bell needs Cialis.
Something, brother. I don't know. Maybe it's me. I'm not fingering the bell properly, but go ahead.
You can't stay up for more
Chip,
than 4
talk
hours.
To us. Talk to us, man. Tell us a good story.
Hey, I wanted to call and just say congratulations. What a pair, man. I mean, you guys are going to do great things. You take your knowledge and your spirit and your love for Tampa and you put it in a show like this, and I think you guys are just going to rock it. And just wanted to say congratulations.
Thank you so much, Chip. You do great things around this community.
Oh, man.
You let people know what's going on. You take amazing photographs. You are the man.
And the Berger brothers have very precious little on Chip Wiener. I'm just going to offer that out there, Chip.
Man, what
all right, my brother. We know who you are, and we need you on that wall.
Thanks for the call.
We appreciate
you,
Chip.
We'll talk to you next week.
Thank you, buddy. So, well, as we come to the close of our inaugural show, let me just say that we're going to be throwing different topics at you. We have some really unique.
We've got a new segment.
Well, we've got unique segments.
Yeah.
There's things that are going to be, you know, like, what is that all about? Or, you know, another one might just be, have you heard? Or in case you missed it. So we're going to fold these into the conversation.
So what did we miss this week?
Well, in case you missed it this week, of course, that was the inauguration.
The
chief and the inauguration of what used to be West Pines Park, now Vila Brothers Park. We want to say, we would be remiss if we didn't say Happy Pride Month. We know that today is the second day of Pride Month. We know that Florida is the epicenter for a lot of bad things as it relates to the LGBTQ plus community.
We'll be talking a lot about that.
And we will be touching on that third rail as we continue. And in one quick fell swoop, what is that all about? Let me just say, what is that all about? Well, what is that all about is a segment that is kind of something that gets under our skin, right, JD? Yeah. I mean, that's something that we can say.
Yeah.
And one thing right now,
the emperor is not wearing any clothes, and we're tired of it.
And we're going to let him know about that. Yep. And one thing that we need to also stress to everybody that's out there listening is, hey, we encourage you to connect with us because we are not us without really your input. So we are excited to be here, John, as we come to the close. What about you? How do you feel, John?
You know, I'm so excited to be here. And next week, I'm really excited that we're going to have some really special additional special guests. Thank you to Chairman Guido Maniscalco for joining us today. It's fantastic. We'll never forget you were our
inaugural
guest.
What better guest?
Next week, we're going to have Patrick Montega and Gene Sudet from La Gazzetta newspaper just celebrated their 100th year anniversary, and they're going to be here to help us fundraise because next week is fundraising. This is
community radio relies on, easy for me to say, the generosity of our residents and our listeners.
Okay, Mario, tell us about this show and wrap us out of here.
All right, so on behalf of everybody, let me just say this again, how proud we are to be a part of this family. On behalf of my broadcast partner, John Dingfelder, our engineer, Jason Marlowe, our phone screener, part-time producer, Lynn Marvin Dingfelder, I'm Mario Nunez, wishing you salud, happy days. We'll be on the lookout for you next week, and we encourage you to stay tuned now for The Skinny with Ray Roa, Ben Montgomery, and Mitch Perry. Have a beautiful weekend, everybody.
Have a great weekend.
Thanks for listening.
Manager of WMNF. Since 1998, my family has attended WMNF music and other events where my kids and I could be ourselves and together. Now I meet the grown children of many of my colleagues who are returning to the WMNF community. They've grown up with the values that we parents share with them and that our kids now bring into adulthood with their children. I call them G2s, second generation WMNF community members. I want to make sure we're around for G3, G4, G5, and so on. That's why I donated to the WMNF Meet the Match Endowment campaign. Join me by going to WMNF.org/